Now, back to Access Tech Live, the latest in tech and accessibility from the Zero Project Conference in Vienna. Back to Stephen Scott and Mark Aflalo.
We're back on Access Tech Live, live from the Zero Project Conference in Vienna. We're having so much fun and we're getting to talk tech.
There's never enough time,
but we're getting to talk tech with a company who are promising. Well, let's find out what they're promising. What's going on with this one?
You've been talking about this for a couple days.
I'm excited.
With us right now, our next guest is, I promise not to mess up names. Cornell Armani, right? No, Amari.
You almost got it right. A bit too Italian.
The company's .Lumen, right?
.Lumen.
Tell us about .Lumen, where it all started,
sure,
and where we are today.
Definitely. So first of all, I was born in a family of people with disabilities. I'm the only person without a disability in my family. And that, of course, coming from Eastern Europe, where we're from, that was particularly tough growing up in such a family. But it also showed me how much technology can help, and also how little technology exists for people with disabilities. So after I had a career in the automotive field where I worked in autonomous driving and everything in that direction, I realized that we can actually use the latest in what robotics and artificial intelligence and autonomous driving can do, but to help people in a bit of a different way. And that's where the .Lumen story begins. So roughly 3 years ago, we founded this company with the purpose of helping people, starting with the following problem. You have close to 300 million visually impaired in the world. But if you look at what solutions are out there for them, for the mobility purposes, you have the same two solutions and they're thousands of years old. And that is the guide dog and the white cane. Now, the guide dog, very nice, works very, very well, but it has a couple of drawbacks. It can reach up to more than $60,000 to train one. And to take care of a guide dog is simply too much responsibility for a blind individual. It's a lifestyle which you decide to have, which is not for everyone. And because of that, in the entire world, to more than 100 million people who could benefit from the guide dog, you only have 28,000 guide dogs. Mm. A great solution, but not a scalable solution. This is where we come in. As I mentioned, we come from autonomous driving and everything. So we took that technology and we scaled it down into a headset, which you can comfortably wear on your head, which does everything that the guide dog does, but without the drawbacks that make the guide dog a non-scalable solution. So what do the Lumen glasses, as we call them, or the .Lumen glasses do?
Yeah, describe what you're holding right now.
Basically, what I have is a headset. It goes around your forehead, so it doesn't sit on your eyes, even if you call it we call them glasses. They sit basically on top of your eyes, on your forehead, and on the back, like a headband, which goes across. We have a system of 6 cameras, which understand the world. They understand where the ground is, any obstacle above or below it. But we also do some amazing things with AI so that we can actually determine what is a sidewalk, what is a road, what is the lake, because just because the ground is flat, it doesn't mean you can walk on it. But a lake perfectly flat, you can't walk on it.
Hold it a little bit higher.
So we use AI in order to determine all of that. And then here comes the interesting thing, how we guide people with it. Because we do exactly what a guide dog does with one important and small difference. The guide dog pulls your hand. So you tell your guide dog what to do and either navigate generally or to go to a particular object or destination. And the guide dog does this by pulling your hand. That's what the guide dog does. What we do with the .Lumen glasses, we actually pull your head. This is how we joke about it. So basically, you have a haptic feedback interface on your forehead, and you just feel how something is holding your forehead, and it's pulling you in the direction you have to go, avoiding you from obstacles, keeping you on the sidewalk, stopping you at crossings, helping you cross crossings, and very, very soon, even public transport integration. So you'll be able to ask for the glasses to take you like the middle of a city, and they will know how to take you to the bus, how to get you in the bus, how to take you out, and how to navigate you up to there. So actually, we're already surpassing the performance of a guide dog. And all of that in something which you can comfortably wear, something which is at least 10 times less expensive than the guide dog, and something that only requires it to charge once a day. Finally, after 5,000 years since the guide dog first came into paintings and everything, there is technology which can replicate what the guide dog does, and even more.
Okay, so I think you've laid it out really well, because I think one of the things that has happened as a result of this being shown off at CES and the Consumer Electronics Show earlier this year was that there's a lot of headlines suggesting this could replace a guide dog. What you're saying is there aren't enough guide dogs to go around for people who want them, and not everyone wants a guide dog. Yeah. And I'm one of those people. I don't really want a guide dog. I'm quite happy having Sticky McStick or Cane McCain, because it's Scottish, obviously. It has to have an appropriate Scottish name. But, you know, I'm happy with that, and that's okay. But I am interested in how this technology can help. Now, interestingly, guide dogs are often provided to blind people
at
zero cost or very low cost in most countries. How would this work in that regard? Because if people are having to buy this, it becomes a financial cost.
That is true. So we have two models in this, and now I'm mostly talking about Europe, where we're from. In Europe, we're working with basically any kind of assistive technology reimbursement program. So already we know multiple countries in which this will be for free. So in Europe, it will be for free in as many countries as possible, and we already know which ones are those. And in the other countries, it will be heavily subsidized. Again, the guide, you do get funding for it in some places. Not all over the world you get funding, but in some places you get. But with the price of a guide dog, we get roughly 10 of these. So roughly 10 people can benefit from the guide dog benefits. And it's true, we do not want to replace a guide dog. If you have a guide dog, then you already have the solution. But very few people want to have that lifestyle. We want to provide the same benefits as the guide dog to all the other, at this point, you know, 39 million blind individuals and roughly 70 million visually impaired individuals who could benefit from one, but do not want to take care of one and do not want to have that huge training cost.
Does it have to be a choice, though? I mean, could it be an option, you know, additional to guide dog or what?
So the system detects the guide dog. So you can actually walk with both the system and the guide dog.
Oh, okay.
The system also detects the white cane, and we actually want people to still be using their white cane. For example, the glasses determine automatically where the white cane is and ignores it as an obstacle and everything. And we want people to actually train while using the white cane. So you can still feel, you know, when the system pulls you away from an obstacle, you will not know that there's an obstacle there because we don't tell you there are obstacles. The guide dog doesn't tell you there's an obstacle either. We want you to understand with your white cane, okay, there's an obstacle. This is why the system actually helped me pass it by. So you can actually, the way we thought of this is you can continuously use your white cane together with a device. Just as some people still use the white cane combined with a guide dog, you can still do that with the system.
Can I hold it?
Of course.
Wait, this, because you know I really want to give a better description of this because it sits on your forehead. It doesn't sit on your eyes. It's got a pretty plastic shell that goes, and this is close to production model, you said.
It's still not a production model.
Okay.
So the production model will still be lighter and smaller than this one.
So it sits on your head like a hat does, like a cap does.
Yeah.
And there's a heavier portion on the back, which I'm assuming has a battery in it and all the components in it. And on the front, there's a little, it's almost like a visor that sticks out over your forehead with all the sensors and the cameras and everything that goes on board. I got to ask the question. I mean, this isn't the most attractive thing to be wearing. It's definitely not as cute as a guide dog, but I understand the functionality. Is that a limitation based on just the size of components and batteries? And are we going to get to the point where, like we say with Vision Pro and other, you know, things like that, where this could just be a pair of glasses on your face like you're wearing now?
We're going to get to that point. Right now, the limitation is basically technology. We're at the absolute limit of what technology can do. In terms of processing power, the closest thing to what we do are self-driving cars. And if you think of a Tesla has just 30% more battery, more computing power than what we have. But, you know, a car is a huge thing.
Yeah.
And we had to condense all of that into something which you can wear. Regarding the design, this design has won the most important industrial design in the world award, which is the Red Dot Luminary Award.
Yeah.
So we actually won that. And just to give you a hint of some of our competitors in the last phase, Apple was one of our competitors, by the way, and we won on top of that. Also, Spaceship Unity from Virgin Galactic was a competitor, and we won on top of that. Now, you know, with devices such as Apple Vision Pro becoming so mainstream, it's a much better environment to have head-worn wearables. They're becoming standard. So something like this is not something which would attract attention anymore as it becomes more and more common. We have over 300 blind individuals which have tested it. We do clinical investigations with a bunch of people, and they're wearing it every day. They don't necessarily see the attention which they receive or anything. So it's, you know, it's getting more and more mainstream and approved as a technology.
When you see Vision Pro coming out from Apple, do you look at that and think, okay, so Generation Zero is it's big, it's bulky, everyone's talking about the weight of it. But then you think about Generation 3, 4, 5, does what you're building become an app?
For some particular cases, so first of all, when we're talking about our patented haptic feedback and everything, you cannot have that in the Vision Pro. So that's the first thing which you cannot do. You cannot have that in the Vision Pro. When you're talking about visual feedback for people with low vision, with reminders of vision in some cases, we do have some patents over there. And we do plan a version of the device which actually gives you augmented reality feedback, but it will not cover your eyes. It will just be an overlay on some transparent glass. You will still be able to see the environment with no obstructions. Yeah. That's something which we are working on now. And that will have the same navigation functionality, but for people with low vision. Getting back to the Vision Pro, it could potentially one day be so. However, the Vision Pro is not designed to work outdoors. Let's see the second or the third generation.
Yeah, exactly.
I will be.
Yeah.
Considering this is a third generation product, Vision Pro will not be on a yearly lifecycle updates. So probably the next generation of Vision Pro will be in 3 years. So by that time, we're going to make it much, much smaller.
And it's not specialized, right? This is specialized. There's a specific single purpose. For this, which is really cool.
This is what fascinates me. Because
wrap up.
What you're doing here is building something which I think Apple must be looking at, or other companies would be looking at, saying, how can we build this and make this useful to everybody, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. What a cool product. Yeah. Congratulations on all the success so far. I cannot wait to see you again and see what the next generations of this look like.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us, Stephen. We're going to take a quick break, come back, and we got a couple minutes to wrap things up here in Vienna. Stick around. It's Access Tech Live.
There's more Access Tech Live to come. Get involved and have your say at Access Tech Live on social media. We'll be right back.